How's it going, pilots? Welcome to your hands-on build review of the B-25 Mitchell available here at Banana Hobby. This is what I'm talking about. This is one serious B-25 bomber here, just under 80 inches. And what we will do for you here today is we were going to do a full hands-on build review and build this B-25 from out of the box to an actual flying B-25 ready for the field. What I will do here today is I will kind of skew away from the manual because the manual is not very detailed as far as what to do and some of the steps there. So this will be my own build review where I'm going to be doing it on my own steps. And then if in the event that you do purchase this from Banana Hobby, you can go ahead and follow these steps and build it while you watch the video as well. There are just a barrage of pieces laid out here. However, still, with this size of an aircraft, with 80-inch wingspan for a twin B-25 bomber, this is very minimal amount of pieces. And the build time will be very much on the down low side, in comparison to like a wood kit or something like that, or a fiberglass kit. This B-25 is absolutely amazing. I urge you to check out the sneak peek, and we're gonna bring you the actual flight review as well after this build. Before we get into this build, I want to go ahead and talk about a couple of the main tools that you will need. Have a couple of different size drivers out ready. A 1.5 millimeter hex driver, a 2 millimeter hex driver, and a 2.5 millimeter hex driver, just in case. And these are just general tools that we will be using. A couple of different sizes of needle-nose pliers, a few different sizes of small Phillips head drivers, Phillips head screwdrivers. I always carry a bunch of different sizes. A pair of scissors, and let's see here. Hobby knife, always. Hobby knife, be careful, very, very sharp. And aside from that, What we will also use today we're gonna use a 5-minute epoxy. So we're gonna go ahead and use kind of a different variation here. We'll use a 5-minute and then we will use a 30-minute as well. And I will tell you where you can apply those and when to apply those and in the event that you wanna use 5 or 30-minute. For our radio of choice with this B-25, we are going to be using my JR9503. And just a little breakdown for you. This B-25 will operate on 8 channels minimum. However, if you choose not to use some of the functions, you could actually minimize it to 7 channels. And what they are basically your run-of-the-mill, your rudder, your elevator, your aileron, and your throttle. And your fifth channel will be your retracts, flaps, bomb door, and your braking system. There's an actual disc brake system. So our receiver of choice this time will be the JR, the 921. And we'll go into more talk about that a little bit later. And also, always have some denatured alcohol or rubbing alcohol, denatured alcohol or acetone ready because the epoxy will get all over your hands and we don't want to have to be a sticky situation there. Some popsicle sticks here for mixing the epoxy and a handful of rags. And I also sometimes I'll use an external receiver pack just for the setting up portions of it. And I think with that, we're pretty much going to jump right into this build here. The stock battery, if you choose to get it, is a brick called the 5200. 14.8 volt LiPo. However, you can also fly it like this, but I used to fly it on 2 4S packs running in parallel, and I think that works great. So you don't have to actually opt for this brick size, but you can purchase this from us if you choose to. I'll talk more about the Genesis powers that we will be using in this B-25 a little bit later. And with that, I think we will just go ahead and jump hands-on, full speed into this build review for you guys and gals out there and show you how this beautiful B-25 goes together. So we are taking a look at the manual here, and the manual actually is building this aircraft from an ARF up. So there are a lot of fuselage joining and things like that. So that's why we are going to disregard this, and we were going to build this thing the Pete style. So we're not going to look at this for now, but we will look into it from time to time here. First of all, I don't want to frighten you out there with the 80-inch wingspan. The wings actually do come off. And the cool part about it is the fact that once the wings do come off, this is the left side, and then you have the right side over there. The wings are completely done already for you out of the box. So the flaps are already linked, and the ailerons and the hinges and everything, the surface control horns and everything are already bolted down, screwed down. So the wings are ready to fly pretty much with a little bit of tuning there. So we're going to go ahead and set that aside. What we're going to start with is this. You want to locate your bag of goodies here. This bag has all kinds of miscellaneous wing spars, wing struts, a couple of Ys in there, and you have your push rods and your surface control horns. So we are going to locate this first. And what I want for y'all to do out there and what we are going to start with is the fact that we are going to mount the remaining portions of the control surface horns. And as you can see on here, there's an area here cut out for the rudder control surface horns. And we are going to mount that on this side here. So we are going to do there, I think, 4 total that we have to install, which is not that bad. And then this is your horizontal stabilizer, and this is your elevator. So we will be installing 2 of the control surface horns here. So right now, we will go into this, and this is the tail section of the B-25. This will be glued onto the main fuselage portion, but we'll do that at a later time once we get this portion onto here. And I forgot to mention, what a cool thing is that all the servos that I know of in this B-25 are all metal gears. So there's no more, you know, strip servos and things like that. And for this size of an aircraft, metal gear servos are a must. And it is a great addition to this beautiful B-25 here. Okay, so these are labeled, and we're going to get that out of there first. And we're not going to mess with any kind of lengths here. Let's go ahead and just get some of this stuff out of here. They're all in different bags, so let's go ahead and set that aside. Let's just go ahead and just dump it. And we'll just pick and choose what we're looking for here. Okay, what you're looking for are the control surface horns, which are these right here. Okay, this is a surface horn backing. The backing, another horn. Okay, there's another horn. There's your 4 horns and your 4 backings. Okay, so everything else here, all these machine guns and cannons and all the stuff that goes to make this thing look really cool later on, to make it look super scale, we are going to just go ahead and put that aside for now. Awesome, as I drop everything everywhere. Oop, I don't need that. Okay, so once you have the surface horns picked out there, we will go into this next bag here and take everything out of this bag, because this is what we're going to use to attach everything here. And this will tell you right here, very, very clear. We do a really good job on the packaging, and this tells you that this is for the rudder. Okay, so this bag will be for the rudder. And then, let's see, let's find the bag. Okay, this bag is for the rudder as well. And this bag is for the elevator, and this bag is for the elevator. And this bag is for, these are for the motor. So we'll go ahead and set these aside for now. And what we will do now is basically install the control surface horns onto the elevator. So let's go ahead and start with the elevator first. Okay. Right now, I will use a small Phillips head screwdriver. And let's go ahead and let's take another look here. Rudder. And these are 2 different lengths. So you want to keep in mind that one of them is longer, one of them is shorter. And it doesn't really tell you what side goes on which side. So this portion, we will just have to kind of play it out and find out as we go. Okay, these are shorter. These will be 15 millimeters, I believe, and these are 20s. No, these are 18s, okay. But these are for the rudder. And let's go ahead and put that aside. Let's go ahead and do the rudder first here. So now we have the rudder, and the surface horn here will be going on the inside of the rudder. So the direction that this will install is this way here, and there is a piece of tape on here, and it keeps it from compressing too much. So you want to leave that piece of masking tape on there, and it's already pre-painted. So this is where we use our hobby knife, and we're going to give this one slit down the middle, because this is also slit down the, there's a bevel here that slides right in there. This is real simple here. We just go ahead and set that in there, press it down, and it's sitting nice and flush, and you're ready to basically screw on the backing here. So we're going to go to this side, and now we have, this is the control surface horn backing. We're going to set this down here, and now you will notice that the trailing edge of the rudder is going to be thinner than the center portion of the rudder here, which means your longer screws will be going towards the root, and your shorter screws will be going towards the trailing edge of the rudder. So let's go ahead and start with one of the shorter ones here, and we're going to go ahead and go into there and just press until it kind of touches the other side. And right now, you just kind of want it to bite, so we'll move this around. There we go. It's biting already, so it's catching the threads on the other side. We're not going to by any means cinch it down and tighten it all the way down yet. Right now, we're just going to have all 4 of these pretty much line up. There we go. That one lines up. So these are the longer ones, and they're going towards the root. Let's go ahead and just line up all of these. There we go. That's good. And then this is the shorter one. So now we have all four screws into the control surface horn for the left rudder. Okay, now that all four are threaded and it's gripping into the control surface horn backing, now we're going to go ahead and just tighten her down. And when I tighten these, I will always tighten them in a diagonal configuration. So I'll tighten this one, and I'll tighten this rear one here. And then I'll tighten this one. Oh, there we go. Okay, and then we'll go to this one here. And when you tighten this, keep in mind that this is tightening into foam, so you don't really want to crank it down. My tip here for y'all out there is when you start tightening this, you'll start seeing little bits of wrinkling or creasing starting around the corners by the screws, and that's your indication that it is well tight enough. And then, you know, like any other airplane, once you have a few flights on her, it's always good to go across and check your control surfaces and check the screws and everything, make sure everything's tightened down again. Okay, so this is one rudder on one vertical stabilizer, ready to go, ready to mount onto the horizontal stabilizer. So go ahead and right now, go ahead and install the other control surface horn onto the right vertical stabilizer, the right rudder, and we'll check you back here in just a bit. But now that we have both control surface horns properly mounted on the vertical stabilizer on the rudders for the B-25, we will move on to the elevator portion. And the same thing with the elevators, there are two bags. One side of the screw will be longer, one side will be shorter. And the longer screw will go towards the root, shorter screw will go towards the trailing edge. And with the rudder, we actually provide you with some extra screws as well. So you want to keep that aside, keep that in the rudder bags later on so that you can use it for spares. So let's go ahead and open these bags for the control surface horns for the elevator here. Go. Let's see. Let's go ahead and identify, see which ones are shorter, which ones are longer. Okay, these are longer. And then the ones over here, these are short. It's always good to have like some kind of a small Tupperware little, you know, boxes and stuff so you can throw these screws in there and they don't get lost and tossed all over the place. But we're just going to go ahead and separate them like that for now, and they're good to go. Okay, let's go ahead and flip this upside down here. And we're going to get our hobby knife, and there are two Hurst surface horns on the elevator, so let's go ahead and slit both sides here. Okay, watch your fingers. Hobby knives are extremely sharp. All right, let's get the horn, and let's press fit that real quick. And notice the angle of this on the elevator is pointing towards the leading edge of the elevator. So this horn right here, the holes will be pointing towards the leading edge. All right, let's go ahead and grab the backing. And something I didn't mention when we were doing the elevator, the rudder portion there, the control surface horn backing, one side is absolutely completely flat, and the other side has a little bit of a bevel on top. That will be your top surface side, okay? This will be facing the top, and then the absolutely flat side will be facing the bottom. And sometimes these surfaces have a little bit of what I call flash from backing, you know, back when we used to build model airplanes. And just little bits of residual plastic around the corner, so you can always just clean that up a little bit. You know, for the guys and gals out there that want to be really detailed, just get your hobby knife, clean it up a little bit, and you're ready to go. All right, so now that we have that pressed on there and the horn is ready to go, we will now get one of the longer ones and we will go to the root section and make sure, there we go, so that's touching the backing, and we will kind of get it to test fit. Okay, there we go. And keep in mind something that's a tip for y'all out there once again. It's not the easiest thing sometimes when you are trying to get these screws to line up with the backing because sometimes they just don't line up. And if they don't line up, put some pressure on your screwdriver and you want to give some directional pressure at the tip right there, and it'll actually move that tip around quite a bit on the opposite side when it's trying to find the proper thread insert hole right there. And it happens a lot where, you know, it happens to me all the time where I can't find the proper angle, and it takes a little bit of wiggling around, like right now. There we go. Okay, so that one's in. Okay, get the shorter one and go to the trailing edge here. And let's go ahead and sometimes you get lucky and it lines up perfect. Okay, so right now all four are lined up good. And we will go ahead and just keep the hand on the backing. Let's go ahead and tighten down one at a time. That one's good. Let me go to this diagonal side. It feels good. Go across and then go back to the diagonal one over here. And that's perfect. And when you look at the other side, you can see that this is perfectly flush. And you want, ultimately, you want the screw just to be pretty flush with the backing. And that's when you know that you have good proper thread penetration there, and that it'll hold the backing on pretty good there. Go ahead and do it once over. That is pretty good there. Okay, so that is one elevator ready to go. And go ahead and install the horn to the next elevator, and we'll check back with you here in just a bit again. Now that we have the control surface horns all mounted on the rudder and on the elevator, we are going to install the horizontal stabilizer here and the vertical stabilizers onto the back portion of the fuselage. Right now, we will not do any type of push rod configuration, nothing like that. All we're going to do is go ahead and install the horizontal stabilizer and the vertical stabilizer. And before we do that, you will notice that this rear section here, the servos and the wires for the rear portion is all bunched up in here, and you want to try to shake it and get it over to the front here, and I believe they are taped down. There we go. So this Y splitter and this extension here for the rear elevator servos here, they are taped together inside, so you want to make sure you get that masking tape off of it. And what's going to happen most likely is you're going to end up unbuttoning, you're going to end up pulling the Y splitter apart from the servo here. If you do, just make sure you line up the color configuration, black to black, red to red, and then white to white, and plug it back in. And this is another tip for you, everybody out there. This portion right here, once you have the rear portion of it glued onto the fuselage, this is just a Y harness with an extension on it. And this is what I really suggest everybody to do out there. If you have electrical tape, get some electrical tape. If you don't have electrical tape, the Scotch tape will work just fine. The reason why I say is this is a connector right here. And it's going to pop open on you. And what we want to go ahead and just tape this down, because we're not going to be taking this connector off here anytime soon, at least. And the reason why I say that is because once you're down to the area where you're actually installing, you know, gluing this tail portion on, you're going to be tugging on the wires a little bit, and it's going to become a real big problem when you're pulling on the wires and all of a sudden that connector comes undone from the servo, and then you got to fish it out, and then it's going to just be a headache for you. So this way we minimize any kind of headache for you, and tape it so that it does not pop off on you when you go ahead and tug it. So now let's go ahead and pull this, get it back through that hole there, and see, now it's pretty much ready to go, and this is ready to go into the front side of the fuselage. Okay, let's go ahead and get that. And over here on the bottom side of the horizontal stabilizer, this is your extension and your Y harness for your two rudder servos here. So let's go ahead and tape that down as well, because we don't want any of these popping off here. Okay. I don't think electrical tape is needed. Usually I just use clear packing tape, clear Scotch tape. You want to make sure you know which side it is, so it's that side there. Make sure they're all snugly fit, and then let's go ahead and tape it down. It doesn't have to look pretty, just has to hold these two plugs together. This is just all precautionary stuff. You know, minimize the chances of things coming undone and things happening in flight and things like that. All right, so that's pretty much ready to go there. Okay, let's go ahead and flip the horizontal stabilizer to the top side. And over here you will find in that same bag, we have two bags of screws. One of them reads screws for vertical stabilizer, vertical fin. So this one's for the vertical. So we're going to go ahead and set this one aside. That is for the two vertical stabilizers. And this bag here is the screws for the horizontal tail. So that's for that one right there. So let's go ahead and get these screws out. There's only two of them. Okay. Go ahead and grab yourself a Phillips head screwdriver. And I would suggest that you don't use any kind of screwdrivers that are like this big, the large screwdrivers. I would stay away from these just because we are screwing this down into foam, and there's a lot of torque going into that size of a screwdriver, and you can really easily just over-tighten down these screws and damage the aircrafts. So right now you want to make sure the extension wires here are tucked in to right about where the center is at. And the good thing about this airplane is the fact that the tail section is screwed down. So if you do have any kind of issues and you break something, you can actually change it out because they are screwed into place instead of glued into place here. So let's go ahead and hold the wires here with your fingers. Pinch it. We're going to go ahead and run this extension through this hole, through this opening here. Okay. Actually, you can set that down first. We're going to go ahead and try to insert that, and I'm going to give it a shake. There it is. Okay, let's see. Give it some more slack. Get it another shake. There it is. I see it. Okay, so there we go. Now we have the rudder Y and the extension coming through here. So we're going to go ahead and pull that kind of. So we're going to go ahead and hold this here, and it just basically lines up. This tab here in the front of the horizontal stabilizer will insert into this area here. I want to pull on the slack of this, and this is what I mean. This is where the plugs would pop apart, but you know what? We taped it, so it's good to go. Let's go ahead and get that lined up. There we go. Tug on the wires a little bit. Make sure everything's sitting good. Let's go ahead and line this up right there. Press. And then back will just seat a little snug, so we're going to seat it. Perfect. That is a perfect fit. Okay. Make sure you have both wires. Everything's connected. As you can see, everything on the inside of there, I don't know if you can see down that pipe there, but everything is pretty much set, ready to go. And we will now, here's another tip for you guys and gals. I save all these foam pieces and the actual crate that the airplane comes in because you can actually end up using it for a cradle, and so it doesn't damage because, you know, you don't want to put any dents in this. So this is a piece of the box it came in, so I'm going to use this. So now I'm going to flip this tail section here, and we are going to screw the tail portion down. This piece here comes right off, and I believe when you're done with this, you want to put a little bit of rubber cement just on two opposite ends, so it'll tack it down in there. So we're going to get the horizontal stabilizer screws that we identified already, and they insert right into there, just like that. Okay, we'll get our screwdriver, Phillips head, and we'll just give it a test fit. Don't press or anything like that, just let the screw find the threads on its own. There we go, and both of them line up perfect. And again, this is the quality of these kits. They line up really, really well. And also, this is where we're tightening it down now, where you really, really don't want to crank it until it's like super tight, because again, this is going into foam. Okay, we got good tension there. We have good tension on that screw. Good tension on that screw. And that is pretty much your mounting of the horizontal stabilizer. We can leave this off for now because we're going to go ahead and put a little bit of glue on there later. I guess we can just put it back on for now. Okay, so this is your horizontal stabilizer mounted to the tail portion of the B-25. And we're going to set this down for now and move right into the vertical stabilizer here. First, we're going to identify the screws, and there are only two screws. There's only one screw needed. There are only one screw needed per vertical stabilizer. And this is the right vertical, and we're going to go ahead and find there's a hole there. And on this side here, there is a plastic mount, but there is a water transfer decal over it. So you want to find that hole right there by just kind of using your fingertip and press on it, and you'll kind of see the indention right there for the hole. And once you see that, you could use whatever you want to use, but I use this hobby knife just because it makes it a little bit cleaner. You don't have to. You can just actually just use a screw and punch it right through if you choose to. Okay, so now that that is cleared there, all we have to do here is we'll locate this here and these two grooves and this hole, these two groove holes here, and we'll line it up and just press. And that's it. That's already lined up. So now from here, all we have to do is insert the one screw into that hole. And we're going to go ahead and let her kind of find the threads once again, which it just did. And I have tension, so I'm going to go ahead and find proper amount of pressure. There we go. You can actually kind of see this plastic bracket here start to bow a little bit, and that's perfect. And that's it. That is your mounting of the vertical stabilizer. So go ahead and find the other side and mount your other side vertical stabilizer, and we'll meet you back here in a bit. So now that we have your tail portion of this beautiful B25 complete, we have the horizontal stabilizer mounted. Everything is pretty much ready to go. The vertical stabilizers are mounted as well. And what we will do now is I'm going to grab my little foam pieces once again, just because I'm a perfectionist and I don't like denting my airplane. But, you know, whatever you guys and gals choose to put the tail section down on is up to you. But we're going to go ahead and do this for now and show you guys a couple of things here. Okay. So right now we have your channel number 4, which are your rudders, and your channel number 2, which are your elevators, and they are these two plugs right here. Due to the fact that this airplane is so big that once you have the whole fuselage assembled and the center of the wing section on, it becomes a little bit of a bear to actually get the push rods connected to there. So this is where, since the tail section is down and the tail section is ready to go to mount onto the main portion of the fuselage, and you have two leads here, this is where I will grab my radio system and I will literally go ahead and set up my push rods right now, so that once I get it on there, I don't have to mess with it again. Right here in the same bag, you will locate two bags of push rods, and they are listed on here. And one of them will say direction push rod, and one of them will say, one bag will say elevator push rod. So we have two elevator push rods ready to go there. And there's a couple of ways you can actually do this for, you know, guys and gals out there that, you know, choose to do it this way. You can go ahead and just power on your transmitter, your receiver, and, you know, granted it's not connected to the ESC, this is why I use an external battery, just a 5-cell or a 4-cell, plug it into the battery port of your receiver so you can go ahead and set up these pushrod lanes for now. And or if you have a servo centering tool, all you have to do is plug the battery into here or ESC with the LiPo into here and that the directional plug and the elevator plug, and you can actually center it that way as well. But I like doing it with the receiver. It's just kind of like a peace of mind thing when, you know, when you're setting it up and everything actually goes together really well. Let's go ahead and turn on the transmitter. We're going to go ahead and plug my receiver battery into the receiver. We've got solid light there. And make sure when you're using your radio, go ahead and select a new model here and zero out all the trims and everything. Let's go ahead and grab the channel number 2. This is elevator, so let's go ahead and plug this into the elevator port on the 921 receiver. Okay, you'll hear that the elevator servos just jittered, and these are the rudder. Let's go ahead and find the rudder. There we go. Okay, rudders are centered. And that's the sound of digital servos, actually. That's really cool. Okay. Let's go ahead and I did select a new model, however, I didn't, for some reason, the trims are off. So let's go ahead and zero out all the sub-trims so that we can start from fresh here. Okay, so now what we will do is we will check the direction of the actual servos moving. We're going to pull up on the stick and notice that the two servos are pushing to the forward direction, which means that it's backward. To our menu here, and we are going to reverse the elevator channel. Okay, so now we're going to pull back on the stick and notice that the servos are actually moving in the right direction. When it's running off of a Y splitter, you don't really have too much control over exactly how much angle you can get the two lined up directly exactly, unless you split up the channels in your computer radio and then do it that route. Then you can actually adjust each one individually. But right now, since this one's looks like it's quite a bit off, we're going to go ahead and remove the servo horn, and we will see if we can find a better one that lines up a little bit more vertical here to elevator. And we're going to try to trim this so that this horn here is pretty close to vertical there. There we go. Okay, that's good. Okay, both sides are working properly. Perfect. And now what we do is we grab the elevator push rod, we will find the, let's go ahead and use, let's see, there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 holes. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 holes. There are 5 holes for the elevator. I will choose to use the farthest outside one, and then we can actually dial it up and down from there. And we're going to go ahead and pinch your finger right here with the elevator and this portion, so you can actually feel that it's nice and flat, and we will line up the clevis here with the top farthest away hole from the surface, the top hole. Okay, let's go ahead and open the clevis here. Okay, we can kind of feel that. It's a little bit high, so it's got a little bit of up elevator, so we will take the clevis, and we will give it half a turn. And let's go ahead and go right back in there and give it a feel, and that is pretty good. That's pretty flush right there. So there, I will leave this, and I'll actually press this down for now, and you can open it back up. Press it down for now, and let's go ahead and do it. Do the same thing with the other side here. Find the top hole. Okay, let's go ahead and move the elevator around, make sure the hinges are free. Find the top hole. That one lines up pretty good. We're going to go actually out exactly one turn there. Okay, let's go ahead and find that. That's pretty flush there. You're going to have to, what you all want to do is once you have the airplane completely built and sat down on the table on your workbench, you want to back away and look down the line of sight with the fuselage and make sure that the elevators are level. But right now, from what I can feel right here, according to that, that's pretty good there. Okay, so we're going to press that home. And now we have elevator. Okay, so that's up elevator, down elevator, and she's ready to go. Let's go ahead and jump right into the rudder portion because it's pretty quick here. You know, sometimes a lot of people wonder why the website says that these airplanes are ready to fly. Just a little bit of history on that. When they say ready to fly, it just means the fact that this thing is pretty much built for you out of the box. There are some limited stuff that you do have to do, like this kind of stuff. But this is the thing. These are the things that actually make these this hobby so much fun, because you get to actually get hands-on and you have your involvement in actually getting this airplane to fly, which is all a part of the fun. So let's go ahead and check the rudder here. Okay, so let's give it left. Left rudder. Let's see. Left rudder, it's pushing. So the rudder direction is good. So let's go ahead and grab the push rod here. And we will go to this side and we'll find the farthest outside hole once again. And let's go ahead and make sure that the rudder is perfectly straight there. Okay. Actually, let's see. Better way to do this here. See if that lines up better this way. No, it's about the same. I would rather, yeah, I like it this way better. It has a little bit of a pinch in that. So let's go ahead and pick the outside hole. Yes. Let me give it a couple of turns out because it's not exactly straight. Still off a little bit. Let's go ahead and do that once more. One full turn. Still not good. Let's go half a turn out still. Just until it's perfectly straight. There we go. That's perfectly straight. Let's go ahead and check the rudder. We have rudder. And we're going to go ahead and pinch her down, and she's ready to go. All right, so go ahead and install your other control push rod to the right rudder there, and we'll meet you back here once again. Now that we have our push rods completely ran for the elevator and for the rudders, this tail section is pretty much ready to be glued onto the main portion of the fuselage. And let me show you real quick here. We have your rudder and your elevator is all set and ready to go. Another tip here, these servo wires are running in a channel here, in a dugout channel in the foam. So if you do have some tape, Scotch tape or 3M Blenderm type of tape, you can go to put a strip down there just in case they start popping out, but it's not needed. These are okay. They're actually pressed on pretty tight and ready to go. So with that, the tail section of this beautiful B-25 is ready to go, ready to mount onto the main fuselage, and we will check you back here in just a bit, and we will move on to the next big step in this build of this beautiful B-25. We will go into this portion now where there's a couple of small things I would like to do before we actually get the tail section installed onto here. And the first of it is, in one of the bags back there, you will locate that there are two LEDs that look like this, bunched up. Open the bag, and let's go ahead and get these LEDs out and unraveled here. Okay, let's get the plug undone here. There we go. They wrap these kind of tight sometimes, so you want to just be careful, because sometimes you can pull the actual plug out of there. There we go. Okay, there should be two strands of individual. There we go. There are two strands of individual LEDs, and they should be about the same length each one for each. Here, let's check here. One of them is longer, one of them is shorter, so we need to identify which one goes where. And these two LEDs actually mount. One goes to the top of the fuselage, which is right here. Okay, and the second one goes to the bottom of the fuselage, right by the bomb bay doors, and it's right here. And sometimes this hole right here will have what I call flash. There'll be some residual foam in there. It's actually a hole, so if you do see that, you can actually just use a screwdriver or something like that, just poke that foam out of there, and pretty much ready to go. So right now I can tell you already that these wires need to be run to the front, and it looks like this hole for the LED is set farther forward than the top hole. So that means that the shorter one will be going towards the bottom, and the longer one will be going towards the top. Okay, pretty cool here. So let's go ahead and this portion I want to show you real quick, and we're using the foam again to keep it from denting. The bottom portion of the wing saddle comes off. It may be a little bit stuck there because of the paint when they sat it down on there, but just go ahead and get your hands in here with the fuselage inverted upside down, and just press up, and it'll slide right out. This portion will be needs to be glued on a little bit later, so we're going to go ahead and set that down for now. Okay, we will take this right here, leave this open, and this part here is pretty much where we run the LED here. Let's go ahead and get the canopy off here. You know, actually, we can leave the canopy on there. I don't think we need to get the canopy off right now, because this is where there's a channel running through here, from the top of the gun tower here. And we will go ahead and just try to use your finger and straighten that out just a little bit. Kick some of the kinks out. Be careful. Don't pull on the ends of it. Let's go ahead and insert the plug into one side. And this is the part that's a whole lot of fun, because you got to try to get that wire to the front here. Let's see if there's a... Yeah, it's not open right there. So we need to kind of guide it in there. Hold this vertical and just kind of start shaking and inserting at the same time. I'll roll it this way here at the same time here. Once the wire gets in there, it should just fall right through here. There it is. As you can see, the wire just came out from right there. So we're going to kind of just actually let that sit just like that. And let this sit right on top of the fuselage. Let it tip over. Included with the kit for this B-25 are three, or sometimes two or three. I'm not sure that they give you two or three, but this one apparently has three in it. This is what I call your stock rubber cement. And the front of the glue is not punctured, so we're going to use the tip here, the top tip of the cap. We're going to go ahead and puncture this. Give it a turn there. Be careful, it might squirt out. There we go, not too much. Okay, this is included with the airplane, and this glue is actually perfect for the later on portions of the mounting of the guns and the cannons and all that stuff. This glue works perfect. And although this is EPO foam, and I use a lot of CA, which is basically it's super glue, and this is MX Bond. This is really, really good super glue. It's safe on EPO foam, but however, you also do want to test it first. But I do not suggest using super glue, CA type of glue, on anything that has clear plastic, because it'll fog it up. And we don't want any kind of fogging going on, so we're not going to use that. We're going to use the included rubber cement. Let's go ahead and get a little piece of towel ready here. Rubber cement, this thing works great. And you don't need to goop it on here. We're just going to go ahead and put a little bit here. Let's go ahead and squeeze it. There we go. On the lower portion, don't put it up until it's, you know, way up on top by the LED there. Just a little bit on the lower portion. Actually, I would use my finger, and I would actually just round that. There you go. There's not much pressure on there. Just need a real thin layer of glue on there. Get that glue off your finger. Get that, you know, your terry cloth or whatever cloth you're using there. And now we're going to go just really easily insert this right into the fuselage. Give it a wiggle until that lower portion is just about flush. pretty much ready to go, and you have the wire ready for this portion here. This is where the receiver and everything's going to go. We're going to go ahead and set this aside, and let's go ahead and install the bottom, the lower portion. This one's a lot easier because it's, you know, it's right there. And we will do the same thing. Just going to go ahead and insert the wire through the hole. We're going to grab it for now and just go ahead and pull on that until it's just about there. Get the rubber cement. Just give it a little bit of a rub on there. There's plenty there. And then kind of swirl it with your finger. Make sure it's nice and even. Okay, when you get that glue off the finger there. We're going to insert that into there. As you can see here, there's a residual glue coming out. So that means that I did not take off enough glue. There's too much on here. I don't want a big goop of glue, you know, squeezing out from the excess once it inserts that into that hole there. However, a little bit is going to come out, and it's actually okay. Rubber cement, if you do get it on your fingers, wipe it off, and the rest of it, just rub your fingers together, and actually just kind of comes off like dead skin almost. So that's how you get that off. Let's go ahead and push this down into position here. We're going to wiggle and push until it's flush. There we go. It's perfectly flush. We have a little bit of glue residual there, so we'll just get this little piece of towel and just give it a once over. There we go. And that is pretty much ready to go there. Okay, we're going to leave this just like this for now because this will be glued on at a later time once we get the main wing mounted. Okay, so that is pretty much set for the fuselage LEDs. We'll meet you back here in just a bit here, and we will get the tail section, which is a big project portion, glued on to the main portion of the fuselage. This is the part where we join the tail section that we've already completed with the main fuselage portion of this beautiful B-25. Couple of things to keep in mind here while we do this. First of all, I want to show you something here. This is a big fuselage, so we want to try to get it, you know, moved out of the way as best we can. These wires, you want to kind of get it out of the way, just keep it clear here. I want you to take note that this portion here of the tail section will be glued on to this portion here. Yeah, this portion here will be glued on to this portion here of the main fuselage part. On this section here, as you can see, the foam is pretty much exposed. There's a little bit of paint overspray there, which is okay. But if you look at the tail section of this B-25, there's overspray on pretty much all the way around of this tail portion here. This is a structurally very, very, like, portion of the aircraft that you want to be very, very stiff with. And I always suggest this. Get yourself a little bit of 600 grit, 800 grit. Probably 600 grit is good enough. And just spend some time and sit here and just, let me go ahead and turn this because I think it's better for the camera like this. You want to get your sandpaper. And you don't want to take the whole thing off. You just want to score this, just like this, and you'll notice that it starts to take the paint off of there, and it shows the white foam. Okay? You don't want to change the shape of this at all. You just want to kind of give it some pressure on there, and then go around and take some of this paint off, just like that. This is what you want to do, to all the way around. And this portion, the flat 90-degree portion on the outside of it, is all painted as well. So it's always good to actually, you want to be careful not to get to the edge there, so you want to just kind of keep it flat. And just do the same thing here. And maybe not so much up and down, because you will get to the edges. So I would probably suggest to just go one direction, just like this. And it's not necessary to get it until it's completely white. I just want some white to show so that the epoxy has some place to adhere to without any paint on it. Okay? Once it starts looking like that, you're pretty much ready to go. So let's go ahead and sand that all the way around. But before I go move on to that, I wanted to show here. I noticed that on this portion of the fuselage, there's a lot of paint. So you want to go ahead and score that with the sandpaper as well. Okay? Go ahead and do that now, and we'll meet you back here in just a bit. So now that we have used our sandpaper and we've cleared off quite a bit of the paint around this portion and this fuselage portion here. You want to make sure you get all the paint dust and the foam dust and stuff off of here. A little bit of denatured alcohol on a rag, and go ahead and clean it off. And she's pretty much ready for your glue in here. Let's go ahead and make sure that there's no more dust there. And then once you do use a little bit of denatured alcohol or rubbing alcohol or something just to get some of the dust off, you want to let it sit for about 5 to 10 minutes. Let that alcohol that's sitting on there evaporate just a little bit so before you get the glue on there. Okay, I think the instructions actually say to use the supplied rubber cement for this portion. I will tell you, do not do that. Do not use this rubber cement for that portion. Go out there, get yourself some epoxy. This is a 5-minute epoxy, and also this is where I want to talk about the epoxy as well. Epoxy is perfectly safe, and it's the strongest stuff to bond, to glue this, to glue just about everything from foam, carbon fiber, to balsa, to plywood, to birch wood. All these woods will be, you know, they adhere very, very well with epoxy. So we're going to use epoxy here. However, granted, this is such a big portion that you need to maneuver and attach to the main portion here. If you feel like you can get the job done before 5-minute epoxy starts to set, go ahead and use 5-minute epoxy. However, I don't suggest that. I would suggest that you all use something about 15, 20, or 30-minute set time epoxy. Give yourself some working time there before you start joining and then something doesn't line up or something like that, and then the glue starts to dry and you're in a real tough situation, because when that glue dries and that thing is off to one side or something, it's staying there, especially with foam. They're not going to be able to get that thing apart. So I suggest that you use 30-minute or 20-minute at least. But for our build and the sake of our build time, I'm going to go ahead and use 5-minute epoxy and take my chances here. What I've done here is I forgot my masking tape, but you want to use masking tape. I've taped the front end of these two plugs together, so it's easier to go ahead and insert through the guide holes here and to get this out through the middle of the fuselage here. And with that said, I think we are pretty much ready to go here. We're going to go ahead and mix our epoxy now and be very, very careful and have this ready to mount together. This part here, if you have a friend or you have a family member, you know, to help you out, it's probably the best way to do it, just because it makes it a little bit easier, because you have to put glue all around here, all through here, and then you want to guide this wire through there and try not to get glue on the wires at the same time. So it's probably better to have somebody help you, but we're going to do it by myself, and we're going to go ahead and have some fun with it. Let's go ahead and mix the 5-minute epoxy here. And I think there was something else I was going to say, but I don't remember what it was. But everything's ready to go. Let's go ahead and be ready here. And we're going to mix quite a bit, because that's quite a bit of a surface there. So this is the resin side of the 5-minute epoxy. Let me see. I think that's about good. It's quite a bit of epoxy there. Okay. Let's go ahead and set that aside. And then we're going to go ahead and get the hardener side. Equal amounts. And I'm going to use my other. There we go. Paper plates are your best friend when you mix epoxy. Unless you actually have epoxy mixing cups, which works too. My dad taught me to build this way, and you know, you visibly can see two dollops, basically, like even portions of the epoxy. Once you see that there's an even portion of the hardener and the resin, you're pretty much ready to mix. And that looks about good there, and you want to make sure you mix the epoxy nice and well. So you want to go to your hobby shops, craft stores, and pick up a bag of 100 popsicle sticks, because these things are like epoxy's best friend. Man, this is almost like a cooking show here. All right, here we go. We're mixing the epoxy. You want to get to the outside corners. Make sure you got all of that pretty much well mixed there. And I tend to do things over the top as far as making sure everything's perfect. So I always mix my epoxy for a little bit longer than usual here. Make sure all that is mixed very, very well. Once more here. Smooth all the way around the outside corners with just a little bit. You're going to have residual epoxy run over no matter what when you're trying to do something like that. And believe it or not, actually the runover is good, because it just means that it's a strong connection there. Okay, make sure you have your stuff ready, your towel ready. And we are going to run this wire through here now. Okay, I'm going to set that down real quick. So I said this area is easier when you have somebody to help you. Okay, I'm going to grab this, put this over here real quick, because I have to run this wire. Oh, that's not good. But it's okay. We got it back up and we're ready to go. Okay, let's go ahead and run this wire. Okay, right through there. And I think vertically is probably the easiest way to do this. There we go. So we're good to go. We're going to go ahead and just press this home now. Make sure you don't have any epoxy on your hands. Okay, there we go. Perfect. Okay, I got some epoxy on my hands. I want to get off here. This is rush time here. Sorry about that. Had a little bit of a tip over there. Okay, so we're going to press that, and then we have epoxy left over there, so we're going to go ahead and just give it a wipe. Okay, I kind of soiled this one with epoxy, so. And this side actually looks okay. Make sure you want to get all the epoxy off your hands here. I kind of screwed up there with the, because I wasn't ready for that. Here we can give it a press, make sure everything is nice and snug. Which it is, okay. Good, give that a wipe on this side again. I have got a mess of epoxy on my hand because that tail section actually fell off while I was doing that. But everything looks good. Oh, we have epoxy on this side too. Get that a wipe here. There we go. Don't worry about this, you know, a little bit of epoxy residual on the outside. You can actually, that's very easy to take off. We're going to set this down real quick here. I'll show you how to do that. Okay, I'm going to get a clean piece of towel here. We're going to use a little bit of denatured alcohol. I would suggest to stay away from actually using this because it'll actually take the paint off. So I want to start with someplace where I can't really see to make sure that the paint won't come off. There you go. Kind of just get that. I'm going to push real quick here and make sure that gap is good. Yes, that gap is good. Okay. I'm going to go take this here. And there's a little bit of epoxy there, so we're just going to give it a wipe. Don't push too hard because you will get the paint off. Check the towel from time to time. Make sure there's not, you know, too much green paint on there or anything like that. Me and my epoxy hands and fingers right there. My goodness. That looks good. Okay, we're going to push right there once more. That's what I'm talking about. I have epoxy all over my hand. We did this for the sake of getting this video made, but if I was building this at home, I would not be using 5-minute epoxy for this. I would be using at least 15 or 20 or 30 minutes. So give yourself some working time. Stay away from 5-minute epoxy when you have big portions of build where you have to join together and run out of time there. But that's pretty much ready to go. I have epoxy all over my hand. We're going to let this set up for a little bit. We'll check back with you in just a bit here. That was a little bit interesting there. That's what I was saying. When you're installing the tail section onto the main fuselage section, it's best to have a friend or a family member there to help you out. I had a little bit of a goofy moment there when I dropped the tail section, and with the 5-minute epoxy, it gets pretty intense there pretty quick. So I've successfully cleaned off most of the epoxy off my hand, and the tail section is set. Make sure you set it down somewhere. Look down the line, make sure everything's lined up. This gap is nice and, you know, nice and small here. There's going to be a gap here, which is not to be worried about. It's pretty much foam inserting into itself. So this is pretty much perfect, ready to go. And we are going to move on to the next step here, which is installing the main wing to the fuselage. Again, here, this portion, you don't, I would suggest not to use 5-minute epoxy. I've actually forgot my 15-minute epoxy back at my house. Go figure. So we will try to use 5-minute once again, and this portion you want to make sure you test fit. This part right here, I suggest you use this stock box that the B25 comes in, and go ahead and cut yourself a U-shape and use it for a fuselage cradle so you can actually flip it upside down and get the main wings glued on there. However, having said that, I have this little cool stool that I've been always using here for many years that I use for builds. And it's just a stool, and I put a towel up on top of it, and this actually cradles my fuselage really well. So we're going to go ahead and flip that upside down and just set her right there, ready to go. Make sure the tail section is pretty set, which it is, and she's pretty much ready to go. What we will do now, oh, actually, you can use those airplane cradles as well. They actually sell those, and those are pretty good. We're going to get the center section of the main wing. Okay, this is the center section of your main wing. Your flaps are pretty much mounted and ready to go, and we're going to install this main wing. We're going to glue it onto this portion here. This is your spaghetti factory of wires that you will need to run a little bit later, and we will talk about that once we get there. This is a servo for your bomb bay, and we'll talk about that when we get there as well. But this is the bottom side, and this is the top side here. Your servoless retracts, everything, are pre-mounted. They're inside of these wheel wells and behind the doors here, and they're ready to go. We're going to keep those down or in the up position, and we'll talk about that a little bit later. Right now, we're going to go ahead and grab the wires, get everything out of the way, and let's go ahead and test fit this to the fuselage here. There we go. Just go ahead and line that up. We just want to make sure everything slides into place before we start putting glue on everything here. Okay. Again, this for an airplane of this size, I can't stress enough. I think it's a lot better if you have somebody help you. So we're going to slide the saddle from the leading edge in first. Okay, grab it from the back here. Give it a little push. And you'll see that the airfoil actually will slide up a little bit, and then we're going to press it down. Press her down here. Okay, that is an absolute perfect fit there. Okay? And once we get the glue laid down, the foundation of the glue laid down, once you have it laid down and the wing in the saddle, what you will want to do is you want to spin this, and you want to get to the front and look down the nose of the B-25. And line it up with the tail. Make sure everything is nice and straight and flat, and you're pretty much ready to go. So having dry fit this, and everything fits in there real nice, we're gonna go ahead and slide the main wing back out from the tail section first, and then we're gonna just remove that portion there as well. And again, same concept as the gluing of the fuselage together. There's all paint right here. So you want to remove this paint here as much as you can before we move on. So let me go ahead and move this fuselage here. All right, let's go ahead and set this down on here. That's my little sandpaper. There we go. You can see the line where the wings will actually stop. And you don't need to go past these little dots here. Just go right up to it, and it's plenty. It's plenty enough. And you don't need to remove all the paint. I would suggest you just, you score it enough so that you do have some foam showing, just like that. Okay, now that we've made a mess here, now take a look at the trailing edge is okay. The leading edge has a little bit bigger portion of an area there. Right here, I would like to take some of that off too. This is all precautionary. I know many of you out there will purchase model airplanes from us, and whether it's this B-25 or any build, this applies to any kind of a build. As long as there's paint on there and there's glue going on there and it's a main portion that's going to be handling a lot of basically a lot of the stress of the aircraft, you should take it off. You could choose not to, but it's just a gamble. It's a personal preference thing. Okay, there we go. That is good. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to use my towel. I'm going to put a little bit of denatured alcohol on here, or rubbing alcohol, whichever you choose to use. I just use denatured because it evaporates a little bit quicker. And I'm going to just give it a wipe down. You can see all the residual paint coming off of there and the debris coming from the sanding. It's all over my hand. Get that off of there. And then just give it a wipe, because some of the paint is still peeling and it will still come off. Okay, we get that there. There we go. Okay, get that. Okay, now that this wing is ready to mount, we will give this probably about 5 minutes and let her sit. Let the alcohol evaporate a little bit, and we'll check you back over here for the main gluing portion of this main center wing section. All right, now that the top of the wing, we've sanded it down, we've cleaned it down, I am mixing my 5-minute epoxy. Once again, I would suggest you out there to use at least 15-minute to 20-minute epoxy. Give yourself some working time. However, I forgot mine at home, so we're using 5-minute once again. And she's pretty much mixed here and ready to go. So I will show you how to apply this epoxy. And I rushed through this section because, again, this is 5-minute epoxy, so setup time is
really quick here. Okay, this is pretty good mixed here. We are going to apply this epoxy to the center portion of the fuselage here. And I want to make sure you keep this away from the, you can goop it on there, keep it away from this edge here. You don't want it too close because it will end up, when you press on it, it will goop out and then you will have a lot of residual epoxy there and it's not going to look good. So there's plenty enough of space up in just this area here that it'll actually keep it down pretty good. It's plenty strong enough right here. Okay, popsicle sticks, once again, works perfect. Get it to the outside there a little bit. Here we go. And when you press it in, it will, again, it will goop in there. It will goop down some too. Okay, as I get to the corners, to the edges here, I will thin it up a little bit. Go. Okay, so now we're going to go to this side and do the same thing. Okay, I'm sorry, I'm going to have to move. It's easier for me to go from this side, so let's go ahead and do it from this side. Because you want the popsicle stick, ultimately you want the popsicle stick nice and flat, so you can actually be able to layer this very thin and smoothen it out at the same time. There we go. Okay, you can kind of see how it kind of just, you can get it towards the outside edges a little bit, but don't get it too close. This portion here, I just put a little bit, I don't put too much. Okay. Okay, as I'm holding this epoxy in my hand, I can feel it getting warm, which means it's starting to set. So we have got to get that wing on there right now. I got a little bit of epoxy there. Okay, let's go ahead and get back to the side. All right, grab your main wing from the center section. Have somebody help you once again. We're going to tilt this. Just get all of these wires out of the way right into the center for now. Okay. Remember, we are going to slide this wing saddle in with the leading edge first and then press down. Okay. It's just about there. Press. And then we're going to go ahead and cinch, press her all the way down. Balance that a little bit. Press that down right there. Okay. Press the back end down. Make sure this area right here, the gap of the trailing edge here is pretty flush with the fuselage, and this area here is flush with that motor, that block there. Okay. So now that it is, we're going to press down in the center, and we are going to take a look and see if we have any glue coming out, which I don't see any on that side. So I'm going to come back to this side and take a look here. And I don't see any glue on that side, so that's perfect. So now, you want to try to give it some even pressure. Make sure the glue spreads out nice and evenly. Okay. And I will look down the line of sight here and make sure that the main wings line up with the tail, with the horizontal. There, it's pretty good. That's pretty right on the money there. We're going to let that sit. I want to give it some more pressure. Make sure that this... I have my towel ready this time with denatured alcohol on it. I didn't even need it. Go figure. Go figure! Okay, let's go ahead and press that down some more there. That is one perfectly glued on main wing. Again, the wing tips on this airplane are removable. They're going to be going on with four wing rods and one main center tube, and it actually, it's a catch tube, and you can actually screw it down, and then it'll lock it in place there. So you can actually remove that, so it makes transportation a lot easier. This is the bulk of the build right here, and one of the most, I'm winded a little bit here. Okay, the center section is pretty much glued in place and ready to go. We will now just let this sit and let the epoxy set. We take a look at it, and epoxy's pretty set already there, but it's not hardened yet. It's still kind of soft, so let's sit for a little bit, and we'll check back with you here, and we'll move on to the next step in this B25 build. Welcome back. Now that we have the main center portion of the wing already glued, epoxied to the fuselage, I forgot to mention, make sure you want to use epoxy. You don't want to use that included rubber cement. It's not strong enough for the center portion of this wing. So make sure you use a good quality epoxy here. This is now glued down in place, and the glue has set and pretty much set and ready to go. Now what we're going to do is you want to make sure you get your whole bundle of wires here. Locate all the tips, all the leadings, the end sides of the all your servo plugs and everything here, and pretty much get it out of the way. And we're going to start with, try to move some of this because the way it's ran, we will start with these two, which is the closest together. We'll move this. And this is the battery plug and your throttle cable. And there's a hole, there's a channel right here, right over here. All of this stuff gets inserted through this channel. And I've removed the canopy down here. I don't know if you can take a look here. The canopy has been removed. So there's a free running area there that'll go straight from there. You can get your hand in there, straight to these wires. And we're going to go ahead and pull these through there. So these will be going through along with the BEC as well. So you got to kind of work it a little bit, try to get it through there. There we go. All right, now that the majority of the wire, actually all of it, it's pretty much ran through that channel here already. If in the event that you do have some wires that you can't reach down in that area, as long as it's through there already, you're pretty much ready to go. So now I suggest you to flip the aircraft, flip the B-25, make sure all the wires are showing, and you have access to all the wires before we actually glue the bomb bay down over there. So let's go ahead and do that now, and we'll check back with you here in just a bit. Now that we have all the wires properly routed through here, I have another tip for you. I was routing it to the front of the canopy area and I had my hand in there, and I realized that there's a gun tower on top here that has a big hollow hole. And that's actually where, let me show you real quick. That's actually where your receiver will be, which is underneath here. So it makes it a lot easier. It's a direct access to the wires. And I actually, because it was upside down, I actually forgot that that's the way to go. So just make sure when you run the wires, you can get it to there and you can access it really, really easily through there. Our next step now is we are going to mount the bomb bay. This portion right here is real simple. The bomb bay has not been mounted yet. I mean, the push rods have not been run yet. Your LED for this portion is run through this slot here, and then it'll just run through the inside of the bomb bay and then out through the farthest hole in the front there. All right, now that I have a batch of epoxy mixed up here, once again, I'm using 5-Minute again. Let's go ahead and take the bomb bay door area, and there doesn't need to be a whole lot here. Once again, not too much. We'll start squeezing out. So I want to keep the majority of my glue on the center section here. And we're going to push down. Push it all the way down. Make sure I press down on this so that it's a nice snug fit until the epoxy sets here. The push rods actually don't need to go on before the bomb bay actually goes down. You can actually put the push rods on there afterwards. So I just made this job all the more difficult and got epoxy all over my hands for your enjoyment, pretty much. And I am very sticky. Okay, this is pretty set there. This gap, pretty flush. I don't feel any epoxy on that side. Let's go ahead and take a gander. That side. Yep, looks good. That gap looks good. Give it another push there just to make sure. Welcome back, pilots. I took a little bit of time here, and what I did was I plugged in all the wires going to the receiver. And notice a couple of things. That right there is actually not that difficult. I know it looks like there's a lot of wires down there, but every single one of them are labeled very, very carefully. So you just follow what the channels are and you plug it into your receiver, you know, wherever it says to go into in those channels. And we did a really good job as far as getting the decals on there so you can identify which wire goes to where. So that portion of it was actually pretty simple. Just takes a little bit of time to sort them out and make sure all the plugs are plugged into the correct places and the connectors are all tight. On your retract PCB board, make sure that the positive and negative polarity when you're plugging in the gear doors and stuff like that are all correct. Follow the plus and minus signs on the PCB as well, and on the braking PCB as well for the brakes here. So everything is pretty much wired up, ready to go. It's still a mess down here, but I wanted to show you a few things here before we move on to the next step here. Right now, everything is set, and I have it pretty much running here on nine channels. So if you opted to use an 8-channel, The LED, actually, the LED goes to a PCB board, and that PCB board, you need to plug that into your receiver, any open port, including the battery channel. If you don't have an extra channel, you can actually just try to find a Y splitter, if you have one laying around, and split off one of the channels so that you can use that as a just a power source for the LEDs as well. Doors are opening, closing. So that's ready to go there. And now let's show you the really cool retractor. Right now the gears are down. Let's go ahead and set the gears up. The gear doors are on a sequencer. Look at that. That's beautiful. And then the gear doors close. That is absolutely gorgeous. What a beautiful B25. Let's go ahead and drop the gears and I'll show you the next coolest thing here. Okay, the gears will open. The gear doors will open. And notice that the it's very, very scale. When the wheels come out, when the struts lock into place, you'll hear the mechanism lock into place and the gear doors will close once again. Just that's exactly how the real scale B25s are. These wheels and the struts are suspensioned. Okay, so they are suspension in the front and the rear. And I have the battery plugged in, but I have it sitting right here so we can get out of the way. Actually, I'll just let it dangle for now, which is not good, but we'll let it dangle. I want to show you something really cool here. Okay, now we have brakes on the wheels. When you come in for a landing and the aircraft is moving too fast, check this out. I have this plugged into auxiliary 3. Spinning, brake. Look at that. The brakes are locked. It's not going to skid or anything like that, but it is extremely locked. As you can see, it's not spinning. Okay, I'll disengage the brakes, and it's back to spinning free again. Okay, spinning, land, lock the brakes. And it'll just come to a stop, rolling stop here. How cool is that? Look at that. We have working brakes on this B25. Let's sit here and do this all day. That is too cool. So it's spinning, we disengage it, and then, wait, let's see here. I think I pushed the wrong channel here. There we go. And it locks into place. Look at that. That is too cool. Well, that is pretty much the build so far. And we have everything plugged in. I'm going to get her back on her landing gears here, and we will move on to the next step. And I think that is going to be installing the main motors, and we'll check the polarity, the directional of the main motors. We'll check back with you in just a bit. Welcome back once again. We are up to pretty much the almost concluding stages of this beautiful build on this B25 here. What we are doing now are we are going to mount the brushless outrunners to the motor mounts and then mount them to the each engine right now, each motor cowl here. And you'll take notice the motors come just like this, pretty much ready to go. Before you go anywhere, before you start anything, I would always check all these screws here. And I believe they are 2 millimeters. So I would get a 2 millimeter driver and I would just make sure all of them are pretty tight. Okay, that's one single motor, good to go. Let's go to the second one. Yeah, see, there's a couple of screws that are a little loose. That one was a little loose. Got a little turn out of that one, and that one's okay. All right, these motors are pretty much tight and ready to go. Actually, there's one more screw that's right here. This is a 1.5 millimeter that is right there. You want to make sure that is tight as well. There's two sides, the opposite side. There we go. These are just things that I always look into, you know, just to make sure. You don't want any kind of failures when you're in flight, during flight, so I always make sure all these are okay. The backside has one 1.5 millimeter collar. We will just check that. Okay, both sides are tight. There you go. Let's go ahead and check this real quick here. It's always good to check. There we go. All right. And these are 600 kV brushless outrunners. These are beautiful motors here. All right. Now what we will do is we will mount the motor to the existing X motor mount here. Okay, there we go. And you'll notice that the motor mount has two sides to it. And one side is actually, it's actually countersunk. So that's the side that you want to make sure these screws go on. So these right here, this will be the back side, and this will be the side here. These are countersunk. This will go towards the motor mount here. So right now, we want to mount this to the back of the brushless outrunner, just like that. Okay. However, before we do that, I always suggest this. Use a little Loctite on those screws. It's always a good thing. You could choose to use blue or red. With this kind of application here, I would use probably blue, just so that you're able to remove it. But because I'm going to be using this aircraft for demo flies. I'm going to use red. Red is permanent. I don't suggest you to use red on any parts of it. Blue is just fine. But I like to use red just in case because, like I said, this is going to be a demo flying aircraft as well. So I'm going to just put a little bit on the threads there. And let's go ahead and do one. There we go. Line that up. Phillips head screwdriver. We'll get that screwed down in there. Don't cinch it down yet. Just about tight enough. And keep in mind right now what we are using are the shorter ones, okay? The shorter ones mount the mount to the motor. The longer ones mount the motor mount to the motor to the mount. Put another little bit on there. Okay, so you have four screws for the motor mount. Okay, once again, I'm not cranking down on it hard yet. I'm not gonna put too much tension on it. I just want to make sure all four screws are in place before I actually go ahead and tighten this down. There we go. Okay, last one. And again, these are the shorter ones that will go from the mount to the motor. Okay, so this is the last one. So now I will actually put some tension on it. Okay, I'm gonna hold it. Be careful not to slip. It's a real bad thing. This is a bad position because if you slip, you will stab yourself with a screwdriver, which is not fun. So you want to kind of give it even amounts of pressure, and then just cinch it down. And always go diagonal to the next screw, and then tighten that down, and go diagonal to the next screw. Okay, and now that all of them are tightened down, I just do a once over every screw. And seems to be good, and we are good to go. Okay, so this is a ready to mount motor to the motor firewall here, and pretty much ready to go. So now let's go ahead and we will mount the other mount on the other motor, and we'll meet you back here in just a bit. All right, what we're gonna do right now, right before we mount these onto the actual motor mounts here, or the firewalls, we wanna check our direction of the motors. These colors are color-coded, however, sometimes the direction it's not actually rotating in the correct direction. And this B-25 does fly on counter-rotating main blades. So let's go ahead and check the direction first here. From your standpoint, when we're looking at this, this is a three-color wire. We're gonna go ahead and just plug it in according to the color configuration that they have put on the string tubing here. Another thing as well, the ESC, the speed control wires, come in through these holes. Sometimes when you receive these out of the box, from the shipping, these ESC wires may be tucked in there. But they're back there, so just get a screwdriver or a needle nose pliers or something and just pull it back out there if you don't see three of them out here. Okay, now that we have that plugged in there, I have not done an ESC check yet, but if you're in the cockpit sitting in the airplane, your right motor will be spinning clockwise. So this motor will be your right motor spinning. This will be spinning clockwise. So let's go ahead and give it a motor check here to see if it's even going to run up here, because I have not checked it yet. I'm gonna grab this, be careful. Okay, we do have motor run. I'm gonna grab it back here, it's easier. Get the gray over here. Okay, the motor is on, and as you can see, this motor, let's go ahead and turn it, is spinning clockwise. Okay, so this is spinning clockwise. This motor's good to go. Let's go ahead and leave that dangling. Let's go to this side. Okay. Make sure you keep your fingers throttled down to the lowest position. Keep your fingers clear of the main motor here, because right now we're just checking direction. The reason why I'm checking it like this is because once you have it plugged in, tight plug there. Once you do have it plugged in, sometimes it's a little bit difficult to get the wires back out of the hole. So it's easier to get this done beforehand. Okay, there we go. Let's go ahead and hang on to this. Okay, this motor, which is, if you're sitting in the cockpit, this will be your left motor. This motor will be spinning counterclockwise. So this motor will be spinning counterclockwise. Let's go ahead and give it some throttle. Okay, and it's not. This is also, so that means that the configuration with the coloration is plugged in, this one's also spinning clockwise. So in that case there, all we're going to do is switch any two of the wires. I'm gonna switch the black with the yellow. Okay, keep in mind, these are brushless outrunners. So you switch two of the three wires. So now I have the black plugged into the yellow and the yellow plugged into the black. And let's check it again. actually. Let's see here. Okay. There we go. And now it is spinning clockwise. You can feel it. So now both motors are spinning in the correct directions. And they are ready to be mounted. So let's go ahead and dangle that there. Let's go ahead and disconnect the battery. And let's go into motor mounting onto the firewall here. Let's go ahead and get the existing machine screws. I'm going to put a little bit of red on there once again. Red is supposed to be permanent, but it does actually come off. But sometimes you end up stripping the head, you know, the threads of it. So be careful. Okay, now that we know this configuration is good, try not to bend anything. We're going to slide this straight into there. Just like that. We want to keep this on the lower side here. Okay. We're just going to go bend and then press and line up the holes here. Okay. I tend to always like to, let's go ahead and do that one first. I tend to always, let's see, there we go. Here we kind of got to wiggle that around a little bit. Here we go. There we go. There. We found the threads. My screwdrivers, I have a little tip for everybody out there. I'm sure a lot of you do this. There we go, line up the X. There we go. I find an old RC car motor or a magnet from a speaker or something like that, and I get my screwdriver and I rub the tip along of it, you know, the magnet quite a few times, and then the screws will actually stick to it because it's magnetic. But now it's sticking to the motor. So it makes it a lot easier to... When you're actually working with small screws, they just stick to the tip of the screwdriver, just like that. We're not tightening it down yet. We're just giving it some even pressure. Again, these are the longer screws that came in the bag of with the motor mount. The shorter ones went to your actual motor, and this one goes from the mount to the firewall here. Okay. All of these successfully found the screw hole. Screw threads. If for some reason you're actually screwing these in and then they feel really, really tight, I would back them out and try them again. Because sometimes if you're cross-threading it and the more you put pressure on it, the worse the threads will get. So if you feel too much pressure, back them out and try them again. So now we can go ahead and tighten them down in a diagonal fashion again. Okay, all four screws. There we go. I actually enjoy this portion. The fact that this B25 has the motor and the mount not mounted, because this part right here, even if you buy a ready-to-fly airplane, I would still take the cowling off on all my airplanes and I would check the motor mounts anyway. Because a lot of times stock from the factory, the screws are not Loctited and they're loose and you lose the motor in mid-flight. This way you have peace of mind, you know you did it yourself, you applied some Loctite on yourself and you use your own strength to actually tighten that down so you know that is actually solid. So this one is ready to go. And now, this is pretty much set. We will mount the opposite side motor here, and we'll check back with you once again. All right, now that we have the main motors mounted to the firewall, we are ready to install these beautiful scale motor cowling. Right now, there's screws on the inside of these. You want to make sure they're tight too as well, which they are. Look at that beautiful scale engine here, the cowling. This is beautiful. So what we will do here is we will just slide this cowling here. And let's go ahead and come over here. We're going to slide this on here, and we're going to line up this screw hole, this screw slot here, with the, there's a screw piece on here as well. So we'll line that up and line up the, let's see here, there we go. And we'll just push it until we can, actually, there we go. There's one slot, there's one piece here, this vertical piece right here. This lines up actually with this slot down here, and that actually makes the lineup perfect. So we're going to go ahead and line that up with that. There we go. And we'll just push it down, push her down until we see the actual screw area. There we go. Perfect. Okay, we got one more push here. Perfect. That's it. And in the bag where we had all the screws and everything, we have a bag that's called... screw for fastening engine, which means the motor cowling. So when you see that, it says that screw for fastening engine, it means that they're for the motor cowls. Okay, there's going to be four screws in here. We will be utilizing two per side. Okay, let's go ahead and get this one first here. go. All right, let's go ahead and screw this one all the way in. And it's a slot in there, so you actually don't want to really tighten it down yet because you can actually position the cowling if you need to. This one looks pretty good. And then I believe on the one on the inside here, this hole is hard to see. Yeah, it's really hard to see. So you want to kind of feel for it. Once you find it, I don't think the screwdriver here is going to be able to reach because it's too long. So we're going to opt for a shorter screwdriver here. There we go. So this one works good. There's not much pressure on these cowling. So you just, you know, pretty much line it up and then tighten it down until you feel tension. That's good there. And everything lines up good. Motor cowling lines up real well. So now we're going to go ahead and just tighten her down. Cool. That's one cowling to go. And we'll meet you back here once again. Let's get this B25 done here. We're almost there. We're just going to install one more cowl. So we're going to reiterate real quick. All we're doing is we're pushing this clear canopy up. And then we're lining up the holes with the holes on there. And these are self-tapping screws that are included as well. And you want to just insert a hobby knife and find that hole right there, and then just screw these clear canopy down with four screws, two on each side. If you choose not to do that, you can also use some rubber cement and glue that on as well. But that was the portion for this nose section that actually lost the power on, so I apologize for that. But this is a very simple area, and nose is pretty much done, ready to go. And we're going to install this gun to the center gunner right there real quick. All you're going to do is snap it into place. Just go in at an angle here, okay? We're going to get this in there. There we go. Just turn and then pop that in there. I'm going to grab that and snap down. Oh, missed it again. Oh, there we go. Okay. We are going to install one main wing. I'm going to show you how the wing goes on and pretty much do some other stuff with the aesthetic stuff and call this a wrap here just about. I want to show you real quick down here. This screw right here, that is your locking screw that's going to lock onto the wing, the outer wing portion. Okay, so that one right there is your locking screw. It's a Phillips screw, and we're going to leave that screw loose a little bit. Okay, so we're going to go ahead and loosen the screw a little bit. It's screwed into plastic, so you don't really have to do much about it. However, if you do want to, you can also add a little drop of super glue on there, give that thread a little bit more bite. Right now, what we're going to do is we're going to insert these wing rods here, okay? There's two per wing. So that's pretty much into place there. And then we're going to grab the left wing here. And this is your locking piece right here. Notice that this will insert into that hole, and then that Phillips screw right there will actually just go ahead and lock down on the groove right there. Okay, so now what we will do is we will go ahead and insert this. And then before we go all the way, we're going to plug these in. And what they are your aileron, flap, and two LEDs here. So let's go ahead. These are all labeled down here, too. So the plug's pretty simple there. There we go. Just line that up. There we go. A little twist. There we go. Okay. Push that down out of the way. Now we just go ahead and push her all the way until this lines up with that right there. Go, and we're going to push her all the way in here. That's it. And then you got, this is the portion where you would ultimately like to flip the airplane onto some kind of a cradle or something like that, so you can actually go to the bottom side and plug in the wires here. So that is one wing pretty much ready to go. And then all you're going to do is you're going to tighten that screw until it bites for the locking portion of this wing, and you're pretty much ready to go. What we're going to do now is the concluding steps, where basically I am going to install the propellers. The next time around, I'm going to put the main wing on there, get everything turned on for you, and then tell you a little bit about what to do. What you want to do now is you have a lot of aesthetic stuff. You have a bag full of bombs and all these little things. Sorry, kind of a mess back here. But you want to follow the manual, and you have things like antennas and things like this. You're just going to use your... All you're going to use are the is the included rubber cement, and you're going to basically mount all the aesthetic stuff onto this beautiful B25, and you're pretty much, you know, ready to go here. And I'll show you how to mount the cannons here real quick on the other side. We just get two cannons. Okay. This is really simple. This portion here, this area here, are for the cannon. So you'll see those two holes or dimples. All I'm going to use is the rubber cement. I don't need a whole lot. There's no pressure on here, just a little bit. Yeah, actually, that's too much. Okay. And you're just going to line that up at the deepest portion there, and then just twist and then push. Twist and push, twist and push, and then have that go all the way in. We are really now at the home stretch of the final stages of the build for this beautiful 80-inch near IMAA legal B-25 bomber. This build has been a pleasure for me to bring to you, and right now we are pretty much installing the propellers and going to give you a wrap-up and probably just head to the field in the next day or so when it's nice and sunny outside. Okay, so the propellers now, keep in mind if you're standing, sitting in the cockpit position, your right motor will be spinning clockwise. Okay, well, you want to look at the propeller and you want to identify that the leading edge is actually angled towards the right and the trailing edge is angled towards the left. So this one is going to be your clockwise propeller. And all you're going to do is there's a hex shape back here. There's a hex shape on the prop adapter. Just get it in there and line it up with that, and you're pretty much ready to go. These are called safety hub. These are called safety hub spinners. These are great. They're actually weighted for a little bit of nose weight as well. And you'll see that there is one singular hole in here that goes all the way through this beautiful machined aluminum hub here. And all you're going to do is you're going to screw this on. You don't need any kind of Loctite or anything like that. And we're going to hand tighten it, okay? And then get yourself a driver, anything that's got a thicker shaft on it, and all you're going to do is you're going to stick it through the hole here. There you go. And you're going to hold the propeller with your hand, okay? And then turn the hub at the same time and just tighten her down, okay? So you're right about there. I think that's pretty good there. Okay, so this, call that one pretty much mounted and ready to go. Okay, and let's go to this side here. And this is the left motor now will be your counterclockwise rotation. Okay, we'll go ahead and set that down. There we go. There we go. And actually, I want to show you something just in, so that for your information, oh, excuse me about that. Included are these washers. These washers will be your preference whether to use it or not. I actually didn't use it on the other one, but they're supposed to go there. And then you want to tighten it down, which works both ways. So let's go ahead and tighten her down. Yeah, that's pretty good there. And actually, you know, I'm going to go ahead and take this side off and use the washer because it actually proves to tighten it down just a little bit better. Because the hub section on this propeller is actually countersunk, so I think the washers will actually work out better. There we go. Let's go ahead and put the washer on there and then retighten her down once more here. Yeah, when I hand tightened it, I saw a little gap there, which I didn't like, so I chose not to use the washer. But now that I notice that, you can actually tighten down a little bit more, that gap will actually probably go away some. There we go. That's it. Okay, so this is your clockwise rotating propeller here, and this is your counterclockwise. All right. With that, we're pretty much at the final stages of the build for this beautiful B-25 here. We're going to just call this pretty much just about a wrap. I'm going to power her on here right now and give you a rundown of what is going on here. Okay, we're going to get the transmitter on here. Plug the LiPo in. Okay, you got those are the ESCs initializing, arming the motors. Okay, let me tuck that out of the way here. I'm not sure where that wire needs to go just yet, so we can find out where it goes. Okay, get that canopy down. All right. And in the meantime, a little bit earlier, I built these bombs, pretty much just glue them together. You stick them in the bomb bay there. And, you drop bombs. Actually, stick a bunch of candy in there and do candy drops for kids. That's always fun. All right. Look at this beautiful, majestic B-25 bomber. This has been an extensive build. So thank you for your patience and sitting with me through this extensive build. And I hope that you can get yourself one of these. You know, follow the build. It went together without a hitch. Everything is working perfectly here. Ailerons, elevator, rudder's good. Steerable nose wheel. Okay, we have your flaps on channel number 6, which are right here. Those are going down. We can give it a little gas here. And she's humming, and we have power. So she's pretty much ready to go. And all the LED wingtip lights are there. It's kind of difficult for me to show you the retracts because this is so big, so I'll show you once again once we are at the field. But let's go ahead and check the brakes once more. So right now we're rolling. Okay. Let's hit the brakes. And she's not going anywhere anymore. So that's something I'm looking forward to trying at the field, because this is the first time that in an aircraft that's electric, in the ARF ready to fly format, that we have working brakes on. I'm very impressed with this model. And my name is Pete. Thank you all always for your support and for checking out this build review. Make sure you check out the flight review coming soon. Please follow us on Twitter, like us on Facebook, and follow us and check out the new videos coming to YouTube as well. This has been a fun build. It's been a pleasure bringing this to you. Hope you enjoyed it, and we will see you with the flight review.